Today's video is brought to you by Card Kingdom, and right now during Theros Beyond Death previews, Card Kingdom is hooking up everyone who pre-orders Theros Beyond Death product with a sweet new spirit token. So head over to cardkingdom.com and pre-order your Theros Beyond Death cards today. Hello everyone, it's Seth. Probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for another daily dose of Theros Beyond Death spoilers. And we have some sweet cards to look at today. We got another Elder Giant, we got our last Planeswalker, a bunch of other sweet stuff, maybe the first against the odds card that we'll play from the set. So we better jump right into it, start talking about these sweet, sweet new cards. Before we do, a super quick reminder, if you haven't already, it would be so cool of you if you could take a second, click that subscribe button down at the bottom of your screen. It's a great way to support the channel and the site for free. So let's talk some Theros Beyond Death, starting with Elder Giant number 2, Croaxa Titan of Death's Hunger. So this is Arrakdos Elder Giant, and this one, it's pretty interesting. 2 mana 6/6, so kind of like Euro that we talked about yesterday. When it enters the battlefield, you gotta sacrifice it unless you escaped it. Then when it enters the battlefield or attacks, each opponent discards a card, and then each opponent who didn't discard a non-land card this way loses 3 life. So the wording on that is a little bit weird. Each opponent who didn't discard a non-land card, basically what this is doing is making it so if your opponent discards a land, they're going to take 3 damage, and then once your opponent is empty-handed and they can't discard anything, you're still getting in 3 damage whenever this comes into play or attack. So obviously 2 mana 6/6 is insane, but much like Uro that we talked about yesterday, you're not really getting a 2 mana 6/6. It's kind of like a 4 mana 6/6 that does something earlier in the game when you cast it. I think that Uro is definitely the more powerful of the two, just because if you discount the creature mode, and they're obviously both great in creature mode, I mean, a 4/4/6/6 with the enter the battlefield and attacks trigger, that's a very strong card. I think that Uro, though, is better in spell mode. Like, Croaxa, you cast it, you make your opponent discard a card, maybe get a lava spike out of the deal. That's fine, but it's not as exciting as drawing a card, gaining 3 life, ramping. So I think that Croaxa is definitely fine and probably pretty decent, especially if you can start escaping into play early in the game, but I don't think it's Uro level powerful. So what do you do with Croaxa? And obviously one of the easiest homes for this is some sort of discard base deck. If you can get your opponent empty-handed, then Croaxa is going to become very effective. It's getting in for 3 extra damage, it's already a 6/6, it becomes a very strong card. Plus, if you're playing a deck that has a discard theme, you can kind of take advantage of the fact that Croaxa's 2 mana sacrifice itself ability is actually doing something there. So we got a lot of pieces in standard. We've played discard decks before. You got Bugler Rats, you got Devriel, you got Rankle, which I think is one of the best cards to work with Croaxa, because Rankle not only can make your opponent discard and you discard, but you discarding can actually be a good thing, because then you're filling your graveyard to be able to escape Croaxa. So it'd be interesting to see if there'll be some sort of Rakdos discard style deck, maybe Mardu discard style deck that can take advantage of Croaxa. Also, people have been talking about Hushbringer with all of these Elder Giants. They talked about it with Euro too. I don't know about this. I mean, obviously, you play Hushbringer, then you play Croaxa. You don't have to sacrifice it. You also don't get the positive enter the battlefield trigger. But, I mean, a 6/6 for 2 is still a pretty reasonable threat, so maybe it's worth it. It feels weird to me, though, to play a card that shuts down a big part of what makes Croaxa powerful. Like, a 2 mana 6/6, that's still a very powerful creature, but you lose the enter the battlefield part of Croaxa. So, I don't know. I think that could be, like, maybe a fun against the odds style deck, but I'm not sure that that's actually the best way to build around it. Plus, with Croaxa, or with Uro for that matter, you're kind of really putting a lot of pressure on your deck. Like, Hushbringer isn't normally going to be good in your deck. Croaxa, if you're building Hushbringer, you're not stocking your graveyard to get it back, or same with Uro. So it's kind of a clunky build. Obviously, when everything comes together, and you're like, turn 2 Hushbringer, turn 3 Croaxa, turn 3 Uro, like, your deck's going to be insane. You're just playing very undercosted creatures. How can consistent will that actually be, though? That's another question for another day. I think another possibility for Croaxa is some sort of 8-rack style deck. I'm not sure exactly where this fits, though. Could modern 8-rack take advantage of Croaxa? It could. It's most commonly mono-black, but you could easily splash into another color if you wanted to. And then Croaxa kind of gives you a backup plan, like you're emptying your opponent's hand. So you're going to play Croaxa kind of as like a bad discard spell by modern standards, but then it's also giving you a backup way of winning winning the game. Like, eventually you're going to get this back because all of your random, like, thought seizes and cheap discard spells that you're casting are going in the graveyard. So you empty your opponent's hand, you get this back, and it's essentially hitting for 9 every turn once your opponent's empty-handed. They probably can't kill it because you cleaned out their hand. They're going to take 3 damage when it comes into play from escape, and then 3 more when it attacks, and it hits for 6. So it closes out the game really quickly there. So I think that might be another possibility. In Pioneer, it's a little more challenging. The discard is worse, and you don't have the actual rack. You just have Shrieking of Fiction and maybe Davriel. But still, I think that's something else to consider. Some sort of all-in discard-based deck in older formats. It could really make Kuroxa good as a kind of medium discard spell, or actually, I guess, kind of bad discard spell that is also a very powerful backup finisher once you cast your other discard spells and escape it. The other thing I like about Kuroxa that I think is worth mentioning is it kind of has a little bit of Siphon Mind in it because it is worded that each opponent discards a card. It makes it a lot more relevant for Commander. I still don't know if this is an exciting Commander. It doesn't draw you cards. It's dealing 3 damage, which is less exciting in a 40 life format. A 6-6, less threatening in Commander, even if it comes into play cheaply than it is in other formats. But it is worth mentioning that you do make everyone discard, which might make Kuroxa somewhat relevant, at least in some style of Commander deck. Anyway, I think Kuroxa, it's a sweet card. It's obviously powerful. I mean, a 4-mana 6-6 powerful, Enter the Battlefield attack trigger powerful. I do think it rakes behind Uro, but I would not be surprised if someone figured out how to make Kuroxa work in Standard, maybe even in older formats in an 8-rack style shell. Next on our list, we have our final Planeswalker from Theros Beyond Death, Calix, Destiny's Hand. So Calix, pretty interesting Planeswalker. It is obviously a Planeswalker geared almost exclusively for enchantment decks, enchantress decks, 4-mana, 4 loyalty. +1, you look at the top 4 cards of your library, you can reveal an enchantment from among them, put it in your hand, Rusko on the bottom. -3, you can exile a creature or enchantment you don't control until target enchantment you control leaves the battlefield. And then -7, you get back all enchantment cards from your graveyard to the battlefield. So Calix, if we look at what it's actually doing, the +1 is kind of like a bad Vivian read, I would say. I really wish, if there was one change to Calix that would make me much more excited about it, is that the +1 said enchantment or land. I think the challenge with Calix is you're going to need a lot of enchantments in your deck for that +1 to consistently be getting hitting cards. I think the spoiler article over on TCG Players said to have a 90% chance of drawing a card, you need 28, I think it was, enchantments, which means if you got 4 Calix, you got 28 enchantments, you got to have like 24-ish lands. You're basically playing exclusively enchantments to make that draw card almost every single turn. So I wish it said enchantment or land, like Vivian says creature land. I think that would make it much more powerful. But still, it is a source of card advantage in the right deck, even if it can be inconsistent. The -3, Banishing Light-esque, basically you can turn any enchantment you have on the battlefield into a Banishing Light, and you can get rid of a creature or enchantment, so not quite as good as Banishing Light, but still, creature enchantment covers a lot of threats. The only downside is, if that enchantment goes away, then you're going to give back whatever you exiled. And then the ultimate, obviously, Replenish. It's a really powerful card. It should win you the game if you're playing a deck that can support Calix and have that many enchantments in it. You're going to be getting back a lot of stuff from the graveyard. So that's what Calix does. Let's look at the upside of Calix. The upside of Calix is we are entering a standard, thanks to Theros Beyond Death, that has a lot of enchantments in weird ways. We have gods, which are technically enchantments. We have enchantment creatures like Dryad. We have enchantments that kind of work like spells, like Omen of the Sun. You could definitely see that being a sorcery. I think it has been a sorcery many times in the past, but it's on an enchantment. So maybe it won't be impossible to play a deck that actually has 25, 30 enchantments in it and makes Calix into a really great source of card advantage. But still, it is a big restriction. You're going to have to cut out a lot of cards that you would normally want to play in your deck because they're not enchantments if you're going to make Calix kind of maximized and really make that +1 work. So that's the good news, is there are a lot of enchantments that work like spells that are actually creatures. So maybe you can support Calix in some sort of constellation deck, enchantress style deck. On the other hand, I think the bad news about Calix is I'm a little bit down on Banishing Light at the moment. Banishing Light has traditionally been a very strong removal spell, but right now in our current standard, people are already very prepared for enchantments, and with Theros dumping a ton more enchantments into the format, I'm a little bit scared that you're just going to not have very consistent removal, and Calix's -3, it's very much a Banishing Light. Not only are you turning one of your enchantments into a Banishing Light, you're kind of putting a target on that enchantment, because your opponent's going to try to blow that up. So that means if your opponent has Thrashing Bronze, Mastodon, our Casualties of War, Disenchant, all of these are cards that show up in the most played list of cards in Standard, things can go really bad in a hurry. So I'm a little worried that because the format is so prepared for artifacts and enchantments, thanks to things like the Cat Oven combo with Witch's Oven, thanks to Fires of Invention, and will probably be doubly so now that we're getting all these Theros enchantments, enchantment creatures, sagas, I'm a little worried that it'll be less consistent than you would like, and it's more of like, I don't know, kind of a soft removal spell that tempos something out of play temporarily, but will eventually be coming back into play once your opponent finds their Thrashing Bontodon or Casualties of War or whatever. I do think that Calix could be pretty sweet in Pioneer. I'm very high on the Enchantress deck. I love the deck. I want it to work. And I think that's a deck where you will easily have enough enchantments where Calix should be hitting a card every single turn with its plus ability. Then the negative seven, if you get to it, is probably going to win you the game. Plus you get more powerful enchantments, Sphere of Safety style enchantments that you don't have in Standard. And the Pioneer format, it's more about fighting creatures and Planeswalkers than it is about fighting enchantments in specific. So maybe that's the format where Calix can really shine immediately. So Calix, I think it's a good Planeswalker. I think it's a Planeswalker that can be powerful in a very narrow deck. You gotta have a ton of enchantments. You gotta have ways to take advantage of those enchantments. In that deck, Calix is gonna be very good, but I think it's more of like Zombie Liliana, where in a zombie deck, it's very good. Or maybe Vampire Sorin, where in a vampire deck, Sorin is very good. Then a Planeswalker like Oko or Jace or something that's just good in a broad sense. Calix pushes you into a very narrow specific archetype and forces you to go very heavily in on that archetype to make it good. However, it does offer a really reasonable reward at basically every loyalty counter if you are willing to build your deck around it. Next on our list, we have Eidolon of Obstruction, and this card, I don't know how good it's going to be, but it's definitely exciting because we're seeing a little bit more Planeswalker hate, which is something we definitely need in Magic. So, 2 mana, you get a 2-1 first strike, and it has a static ability that makes it so loyalty abilities on Planeswalkers your opponents control cost 1 more to activate. So basically, once you get down Eidolon, it's going to be a little bit tougher for your opponent to activate a Teferi, Nissa, or a Vraska. So the good news is Eidolon, it does a nice job of tempoing Planeswalkers out of the game. Planeswalkers like Teferi get much worse when you can't just play them on turn 3 and immediately bounce something, or immediately plus. You can't just play Nissa and immediately untap a land. You can't Vraska and immediately destroy something or sack something. So it is a nice tempo play. On the other hand, this is just a tempo play. After your opponent untaps, with any of these Planeswalkers, things get a lot worse. So maybe you force your opponent to play off curve a little bit, because once your opponent untaps, they're going to have a ton of mana with Nissa, so they don't really care. They can easily pay an extra to activate their Nissa. They can just activate Vraska and kill Eidolon. They can use Teferi to bounce Eidolon. So I think that this is a card that you want to back up with an aggressive clock. And I think that's the main fit for something like Eidolon of Obstruction. It is a pretty reasonable creature against aggro, which means it is relevant in a lot of matchups. Against control, you're taxing Planeswalkers. Against aggro, a 2-1 first strike actually blocks a lot of the format. Blacklands, Paragons, and Gutterbones, and Tide Takers. So that is a nice upside there as well, which I think means Eidolon probably going to be a staple of like the white weenie style deck. I don't know if it can branch out beyond that or not, but it's good enough as a creature that you can play it in that deck. It's good enough in multiple matchups where you're not going to be embarrassed to have it in your main deck, and then sometimes it's going to be really, really great when it stops your opponent from activating that Vraska just one more turn and you kill your opponent, or Teferi to bounce something, whatever. So I think that Eidolon, it's not a hard lock to Planeswalkers by any stretch, but its ability to tempo Planeswalkers out, slow them down just a little bit, is probably going to make it good enough to see play. I don't know if the ability is strong enough to make this like a sideboard staple. We'll have to see. It is also worth mentioning that it's not a legend. So in theory, you can stack these up. If you get like two or three of them on the battlefield, then you kind of hardlock Planeswalkers out of the game altogether. So that is an option. Not sure if it's going to be good enough to be like a sideboard hoser, just because basically kind of like a mana tithe. You're making your opponent play off curve more than you are locking them down completely. However, if you're in an aggro shell, that one turn where you slow down your opponent's Planeswalker will probably be enough that you can kill the Planeswalker or maybe just kill your opponent and win the game. We also got Taranika, a Crowan veteran. And speaking of aggressive white decks, I think that's where you want to be with this. 3 mana, you get a 3/3 legendary human soldier. It has vigilance. When it attacks, you get to untap another target creature you control and basically make it into a 4/4 until end of turn. And it even gains indestructible. So you can use this on a small creature. And I think that's the main home for this deck. It's kind of like as the top end of your aggro deck. If you're playing like Healer's Hawk and Fairy Godmothers and Loyal Pegasus, all cards that are showing up in white weaning right now, this becomes a pretty legitimate threat. You play this on turn 3. On turn 4, you attack with it. You target like your Healer Hawk. You untap it. You make it a 4/4. You gain 4 life. Hit your opponent for a bunch of damage. Same with any of your other flyers. The only downside is Tarkana itself might trade off in combat. A 3/3 isn't very massive compared to like Cavaliers that are running around, Sphinx of Foresights, all the big stuff that we're getting, like the Titans from Theros. But if you can get in enough damage quickly enough, you might only need one or two attacks, turning like your random flyer into a 4/4 to close out the game. The other place this card I think is exciting is maybe we can see a revitalization of Boros aggro. Boros still has a lot of pieces in the format, thanks to Ravnica Block, which is floating around, and it's gotten some new additions recently. Like, Hakdos has potential to be an absurd card in a Boros aggro deck. It is a reason, I think, to play a bunch of red and white mana. We have Swiftblade Vindicator, which is, like, best friends with Tarkanara. Like, you can target this, make it a 4/4 indestructible double strike vigilance trample. It does not take many attacks for that to close out the game, and you can even throw Embercleave on the creature, and then all of a sudden, things become super frightening. Can you imagine, like, Hakdos with Embercleave? That's a 2-turn clock. Can you imagine any creature being targeted by Tarkana with an Embercleave? That's going to be a 2-turn clock as well. So maybe we can have some sort of go-wide Boros aggro deck that combines some of our new stuff from Theros Beyond Death with some old cards from Ravnica Block, and it might actually be pretty powerful. Next on our list, we have one of my favorite cards from the entire set, Thassa's Oracle. So Thassa's Oracle, double blue, Merfolk Wizard. You get a 1/3. When it enters the battlefield, you get to look at the top X cards of your library, where X is your devotion to blue. Put one of them on top of your library, the rest on the bottom in random order. But that's not that exciting. I mean, that's kind of meh. However, what makes this really exciting is the last text. If X is greater or equal to the number of cards in your library, you win the game. So as a card draw effect, this doesn't do anything. You're putting a card on the top of your library, it doesn't even draw a card. What you really want to be doing with Thassa's Oracle is using it to win the game. So this reminds me the most of effects like Jace Wielder of Mysteries, Laboratory Maniac. It does something similar. It rewards you for having very few cards in your library. The upside of Thassa's Oracle is if you can get some devotion to blue on the battlefield, you don't actually need to have zero cards in your library. You can have like 10 cards in your library and cast this, have enough devotion to blue, win the game on the spot. Also, unlike some other you win the game cards, this one wins when it resolves. There's no like at your upkeep, at your end step. You just cast this, it triggers, you win the game. So it's going to be very difficult to stop. So I think that this can obviously fit in decks that are already playing Jace Wielder of Mysteries, already playing Laboratory Maniac, especially if you are heavily in on blue. Also opens up some sweet combo potential in basically every format. In standard, this is a great reward for milling yourself. Maybe you just play a ton of self-mills, Secret Keepers and Emrys and Jace's, mill, get some random mana symbols on the battlefield, eventually play Thassa's Oracle, win the game by surprise. That actually seems pretty reasonable, pretty practical. I think that that plan could work. In older formats, you get some very scary combos, potentially. We played a deck in Pioneer, which is still one of my favorite Pioneer decks we've played, with Risen Reef and Master of Waves and Nibon, where you're just trying to basically draw your entire deck in this blue devotion shell and eventually win with Jace. Thassa's Oracle is a huge upgrade over Jace. It's adding 2 blue mana symbols on turn 2. It's a tribe member, so it is a wizard, so that works well with Nibon. It's upping your devotion count for Master of Waves quicker than Jace, and then it's winning faster than Jace. Like I said, if you get a bunch of blue mana symbols on the battlefield, you don't have to actually empty your entire library. This can win with 10 cards in your library, 20 cards in your library. So I think it's an easy inclusion in something like that. As you move back to older formats, let's say Commander, or in some of these work in Modern as well, something like Leveler should just win you the game. Leveler comes down, exiles your library. Thassa's Oracle, even with no other blue mana symbols, triggers, wins you the game. In Commander, you can potentially win the game like on turn 1 or turn 2 with Demonic Consultation, which has a lot of weird text on it. But basically, if you name a card that's not in your deck, it's 1 mana, exile your entire library at instant speed. So if you can follow that up with Thassa's Oracle, even with no other blue mana symbols, you just win the game. So in theory, you could do something like fast mana, Demonic Consultation, Thassa's Oracle, turn one win in Commander. Hermit Druid, also, if you don't play any basic lands, just mills your entire deck. Another way to set up the Thassa's Oracle kill. So there's tons of combos in older formats that can make Thassa's Oracle good. So I'm super hyped for this card. I would not be surprised if this was our very first against the odds card, probably in Standard, but I definitely think this can actually be playable in something like that Risen Reef deck, in Pioneer, in Commander decks for sure, maybe some janky combo decks in Modern. This card is just super sweet. It's a way to up your devotion. It's a fine blocker on the early game, and then all of a sudden it can win the game out of the blue all by itself in the late game. Such a super sweet design. Finally today, we got some lower rarity stuff, starting with Ichthyomorphosis. So Ichthyomorphosis, this card's actually pretty reasonable. In Limited, I don't think it's a constructed spell, but 3 mana, you make a creature lose all of its abilities, become a 0/1. We've seen some of these, like, sort of see play in Constructed, especially in, like, mono-blue decks that are really starved for removal. But mostly, Ichthyomorphosis is just a good Limited removal spell. We also got a ton of other stuff that's mostly relevant for Limited. Soul-Guided Lantern, pretty reasonable graveyard hate spell, actually. I don't think it's quite on the level of, like, Relic of Progenitus, but it is sweet with Emery, because it can draw you a card, and it only exiles your opponent's graveyard, which means you can do this repeatedly with Emery, which definitely has some potential in various formats, compared to Relic, which exiles itself on resolution, so you can't keep getting it back with Emery, doing it again, doing it again, doing it again. So I think it might have applications in specific decks, although I think it ranks just a little bit behind Tormod's Crypt or Relic of Progenitus in most decks. Otherwise, the red cards, mostly Limited fodder, Altar of the Pantheon, kind of interesting. It's a 3-mana mana rock that increases your devotion to any color combination that you want, essentially by 1. So it essentially is all colors for devotion purposes. And then you can maybe gain a little bit extra life if you have a legendary enchantment god or demigod. I think this is decent as far as 3-mana mana rocks go. It's nice that it's relevant in devotion decks when mostly colorless mana rocks would not be. Sea God Scorn, definitely just limited fodder. Anyway, that brings us to the end of our daily Theros Beyond Death spoilers for today. So let me know what you think about these crazy new cards. What do you think about our Rakdos God? How does that compare to Uro? What do you want to do with it? What about the new Planeswalker, Calix? Is that better than I'm giving it credit for? How many enchantments do you need? How can you fit that many enchantments in your deck and actually make it work? How sweet is Thassa's Oracle? What other combos are there to win as quickly as possible? Or what kind of fair deck can you play it in? What about Eidolon of Obstruction? Is that the Planeswalker hate we've been waiting for to slow down all the War of the Spark Planes? Planeswalkers. What about Tekkenara? Can that be a part of an aggressive white deck? What about all the lower rarity stuff? Let me know what you think about that as well. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.